brought to you by Penguin.
Charles, The Heart of a King, by Catherine Mayer. Read by Sally Scott, with a new introduction written and read by the author. Preface to the New Edition, 2022. It must come soon, he knows, the call he has dreaded since childhood. 10 days of ceremonial will follow, with plans and protocols guiding his every move, agreed more than a decade ago, and recently updated to reflect departures from the front ranks of his family. For months, senior officials pored over the choreography, considered the symbolism, perfected a message of reassurance and renewal. For all this, they left their leading player without a route map for navigating the conflict at the heart of the pageant. In becoming king, Charles loses much that he holds dear, and this is just the beginning of an inventory of pain and risk. His entire life has been shaped and distorted by a singular destiny: to inherit the crown, preserve it, and pass it on. Until recently, only the first of these duties appeared daunting. The love of a son for his mother, his flinch from contemplating her death, the rawness of grief when that moment comes. These things should be obvious, and will be to anyone who knows him. Even then, and despite the fact that he will be relentlessly on show during the rituals of accession and state commemoration, he cannot rely on uninflected sympathy. This isn't merely because most of the countries Queen Elizabeth II has served as head of state will mark her passing, though they will voluminously, or that media coverage everywhere will be inescapable and protracted, the tears and tributes of people brought up to articulate emotions perhaps more relatable than his. Prominent deaths also force us to contemplate our own losses, fears, and fragility. And the Queen is the most famous woman in the world. She has been a presence, however remote, for close to a century. Only a tiny fraction of the global population has ever experienced life without her. In February 2022, she passed a milestone, 70 years on the throne, the longest reigning British monarch in history. She has come to define the role, set its terms, model a way to do it and be it, but the connection goes deeper. Everywhere, people dream of her, without knowing why. She is entangled, though we may not yet realise to what extent, with our own memories. For many, she embodies constancy, immunity to fad and fashion, perhaps a false promise of immortality. When she dies, the wash of anguish, inchoate and profound, could buoy her heir or submerge him. The stones of his past weigh him down. Perceptions of public figures are coloured not only by social attitudes, but narratives that, once sown, prove tougher to eradicate than ground elder. The Prince of Wales, in divorcing the only woman as instantly recognisable as the Queen, and many times more expressive, inadvertently typecast himself as coldly passionless, intensely self-involved. Though there is some merit to the second point, the first couldn't be further from the truth. Charles brims with emotion. Nevertheless, if he endures the rites for his mother immobile and outwardly unmoved, as he has been trained, and as she would want him to do, then he risks reinforcing that old myth. There will anyway be those whose dislike of the monarchy, or of Charles himself, blocks compassion for him. Others whose sadness turns to irritation as sporting fixtures, festivals, and favourite programmes give way to solemnities. Both Charles and his mother are unambiguously old, at time of writing 73 and 96 respectively. While the Queen, by continuing to work into her 10th decade, has transcended the cultural reflexes that routinely undervalue the lives of her older subjects, her son is unlikely to be so fortunate. She had a good innings, people will tell the stricken king, as if to mourn anyone at or beyond average life expectancy is an indulgence. an intertwined strand of popular bias, questions Charles's fitness at his advanced age to take the throne. If these were normal times, none of this would seriously affect his chances of a successful reign. But these are not normal times. Charles needs all the goodwill he can get. His mother has navigated many tests. These are as nothing compared to the challenges he faces, more than a few of his own making, or brewed within family and the firm, as the amalgam of royal households is known. This biography, first published in 2015 and updated for paperback a year later, anatomized the man who would be king. Character is an important consideration in assessing any kind of leader, all the more so in the case of a monarch who is gifted or lumbered with the role rather than earning it, and free from many of the checks and balances that curb the behaviors of politicians or business executives. Charles clings to conventions and legal protections that shield him and the workings of his court, his interventions, initiatives, organizations, and finances from direct interrogation. His effigy garnishes stamps and coins. His portrait festoons government buildings across the remnants of the empire. His avatar has been served up in press reports and soapified in popular drama, and still he remains obscure. A lot of what is written and reported about him misses the point, is plain wrong, even ridiculous. He is apt to complain about this, while vigorously perpetuating the systems that help to create the distortions. My reporting, based on unusual levels of access to him, and interviews with his friends and critics, court insiders and close observers, revealed a complex person, full of human contradictions, funny by design and sometimes by accident, literally entitled yet riddled with insecurities, and more engaging than you might expect. My research also exposed key elements of the gathering crisis now threatening the Windsor dynasty, failings and organizational weaknesses, toxic behaviors concealed rather than excised. Infighting has undermined efforts to unify the warring royal courts. Scandals rattle palace doors. Charles's surprising belief system brings him again and again into conflict. Yet I will not pretend to wisdom after the fact. The foundations of the monarchy appeared to me and the vast majority of the many sources I interviewed surprisingly secure for an antique construct. Polls reinforce this view. These days, however, cracks are visible and widening. What happened to transform the picture so dramatically? I begin this new edition with two new chapters exploring that question and the six intervening years that have hit the institution like a wrecking ball. The Harry and Meghan years, the Prince Andrew and Jeffrey Epstein years, the cash for honours years, and the fragmenting and fracturing of family years. These strands, corrosive in isolation, are more potent still in combination. At Prince Philip's 2021 funeral, the Queen hunched alone in her pew for a service scaled down by COVID precautions from stateliness to mortal dimensions, an icon of grief and dignity. By the time of Philip's larger memorial the following year, attention focused less on his fragile widow than the jarring prominence of their second son, Andrew, who escorted her into Westminster Abbey despite his supposed banishment from public life. Also eye-catching was the absence of their grandson, Harry. In January 2022, the Queen stripped Andrew of his titles and patronages, but it is the younger prince who spends his days in exile. In giving voice to what Oprah Winfrey, the host of an explosive TV special, called Their Truth, Harry and wife Meghan described a palace culture shot through with racism and insensible to the despair of a woman in its midst, much as it had been for his mother. There were rebuttals, of course, but the account chimed with Andrew's casual arrogance in the BBC interview 15 months earlier that helped to precipitate his forced retirement as a working royal. How could he have stayed with Epstein, a convicted paedophile, and managed to overlook the victims of abuse under his royal nose? Newsnight's Emily Maitlis wondered, quoting the lawyers for one of those victims, Virginia Giuffre, née Roberts. You could not spend time around Epstein and not know. I live in an institution at Buckingham Palace which has members of staff walking around all the time. And I don't wish to appear grand, but there were a lot of people who were walking around Jeffrey Epstein's house, Andrew replied. It's tough to imagine how any member of the royal family could single-handedly do more damage to its reputation.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.